I turn now to our sermon text for this morning. I'll be reading from the letter to the Hebrews, a New Testament text. And I'll be reading chapter 12, verses 18 through 29. Hear now the word of God for our day. You have not come to something that can be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom and a tempest and the sound of a trumpet and a voice whose words made the hearers beg that not another word be spoken to them, for they could not endure the order that was given. If even an animal touches the mountain, it shall be stoned to death. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I tremble with fear. But you have come to Mount Zion, and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. See that you do not refuse the one who is speaking. For if they did not escape when they refused the one who warned them on earth, how much less will we escape if we reject the one who warns from heaven? At that time his voice shook the earth, but now he has promised, yet once more will I shake not only the earth but also the heaven. This phrase, yet once more, indicates the removal of what is shaken, that is, created things, so that what cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us give thanks, by which we offer to God an acceptable worship with reverence and awe, for indeed our God is an all-consuming fire. The word of the Lord. This morning marks the third Sunday in our sermon series on faith. The first sermon in the series addressed the confidence that characterizes faith, the assurance of things hoped for is all we really need to carry us home from life's wilderness experience. And last week we heard about the list of faithful people, people in our lives who accompany us along with Christ on a long and difficult faith journey. We learned that faith requires both perseverance and companionship. Today we face a challenging text that contains both a warning and a reminder. We are advised to accept God's gracious invitation to come home, joining the faithful in God's kingdom. We are also reminded that God is all-consuming fire. This morning, we will try to understand just what this passage means and whether there might be any good news for us in it today. Let's begin with prayer. God of grace and God of mercy, we give thanks for your gift of new life in Christ, that you have redeemed us and call us your own. Help us understand you more clearly. Give us ears to hear your word in Scripture. Grant us courage to be Christians and hope that we will grow in our faith with each new day. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Earlier this week, I was staring down a dragon. I was studying it. I was trying to figure it out. It was a 17th century engraving of a dragon, to be precise. There was also a fox and two roosters involved. The image was engraved at the direction of a Benedictine monk called Basil Valentine, who lived in the early 1600s. The picture he had published was of a dragon in the foreground, crouching sideways at rest. There was a second image drawn in the background behind the dragon, showing a rooster eating a fox, eating a rooster. The rooster was standing on the fox's back, biting its neck, while the fox was consuming yet another rooster already half eaten. It was very strange. Very mysterious. Monk Basil, it turns out, was immersed in the lost art of alchemy. The goal of the alchemist was to liberate parts of the cosmos away from their temporal existence, so as to achieve their perfection. Now, achieving perfection meant, for metals, transforming from a base metal into gold, the perfect metal. And for humans, our perfection was understood to mean longevity, then immortality, and finally, redemption with God. Alchemy developed as something of a mystical science. It was a mixture of primitive physics and chemistry with some religion and philosophy all mixed in. Basil Valentine, the monk, published his alchemist recipe using allegorical images and text. But you needed to see and understand the images in order to make use of his written notes. They work together. For centuries, no one understood the allegory of Monk Basil's engraving, the dragon, the rooster, the fox. Until finally, one day, a professor of chemistry and history of science at Johns Hopkins University discovered not only the dragon allegory's meaning, but also a surprising level of chemical sophistication for medieval times. Monk Basil's dragon picture turned out to be the chemical equation for transforming gold into its crystallized form, an important process that works in both directions, into and out of a solid, with the help of a chemical agent symbolized by the red fox. The chemistry professor cracked the code of the allegorical picture. He found that the rooster stands for gold from its association with the sunrise and the sun's association with gold. And the fox represents aqua regia, a combination of nitric and hydrochloric acid that can dissolve gold. A repetitive process of dissolving, heating, and redissolving, the rooster eating the fox, eating the rooster, leads to the buildup of chlorine gas, which, when contained in a flask with gold metal inside it, will turn the gold into gold chloride. Gold chloride is a solid whose red crystals were known back in medieval times as dragon's blood. Pretty neat. Monk Basil was way ahead of his times. The chemical reaction he described was not reported in modern chemical literature until 1890. Only later would more modern chemists take Monk Basil's formula to heart and do something really ingenious. What they did, or what this one person did much later, involved alchemy of sorts, and some evildoers, and a race for gold, like an Indiana Jones movie. Except, this was not a movie. But before we go there, let's consider another very explosive situation, the burning fire smoke, and storm on the mountain of Sinai, and the absolute awe and terror felt by the Israelites who were with Moses there. The writer of the letter to the Hebrews reminds us not to turn our backs on God's grace. It's a friendly reminder, but when recast in the light of what the Israelites had experienced, we are well advised to take heed. Remember that on Mount Sinai, which is referenced but not named explicitly in this passage, there was something that could be touched and seen, a physical blazing fire and darkness and gloom and a tempest. In other words, when God called Moses to the mountaintop and the people who had just recently escaped the horrors of bondage in Egypt huddled all around at the base camp of the mountain waiting for Moses to return, the presence of God was very powerful, very palpable, and very scary. There was the sound of a trumpet, a voice whose words made the hearers beg that not another word be spoken to them. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that even Moses said, "I tremble with fear." The people wanted to run away. In fact, from then on, they sent Moses up to talk to God on his own. They couldn't handle facing God themselves. Yet the blazing fire on Mount Sinai is immediately juxtaposed against the peaceful image of Mount Zion, the heavenly promise of the city of the living God. You'd almost miss the fact that there are two mountains if you did not know that Moses was on Mount Sinai and the revelation of God's heavenly city comes to us from Mount Zion. It may not have been an accident that the two mountains were never named as being different. I don't want to give the whole thing away, but it is almost as if we are hearing about one and the same mountain, but with a Moses side and a Jesus side. And when you get to the top, you find yourself at the same place, alongside God. It can be a terrifying place, or it can be a resting place. With Jesus as intercessor, the journey is smoother somehow. With Jesus, there's not that sense of there being a kind of toxic reactivity in approaching God. Instead, on top of Mount Zion, there are angels in festal gatherings. There is the assembly of the firstborn. That would be Jesus' followers. There is Jesus himself and his sprinkled blood that brings forgiveness and redemption. The blood of Christ does not call out for revenge like the blood of Abel. Christ's blood calls for an end to the violence. Christ's sacrifice is the gracious gift of God that brings us our salvation, our return to God's open embrace. Without Christ, we are lost and outcast, too impure, unclean, and unholy to even approach God. That is the impurity that tripped up the Israelites. They were almost radioactive in approaching God. The Israelites at Mount Sinai would be struck dead if even an animal of theirs were to touch the mountain. All people were impure and unable to purify themselves, in fact, before Jesus came. Humanity needed an intercessor, and only a divine intercessor, someone as pure as gold, as perfect as Jesus, could bridge the gap between us and our Creator. That is why the Jesus side of the mountain is so much easier to climb, why we are not met with a tempest and gloom and burning fire, but with a warm embrace and a welcome home from God. So then, why the reminder in Hebrews to persevere in our faith? Why are we given the warning not to ignore God's call to faithfulness? Why in the world would we ignore God now, when the reward is so great? Perhaps it's because God knows we would turn our backs on God if we were shaky in our faith, if we were thinking about turning back to our bad old ways, to deny Jesus, to fall out of step with our commitment to God, to opt out, to choose not to follow Christ, but instead to follow our own interests and forget the basics of loving God and loving neighbor. These were the temptations that faced the hearers of the letter to the Hebrews. And perhaps they are the temptations that we face as well. So what is the good news about Jesus Christ? What news is good enough to give us hope and motivate us, keep our faith alive, to heed the advice to follow God's call, to try our best to live a Christian life? Why? Why do we bother? The answer lies at the center of what we believe about our relationship with God and who God is. We believe as Presbyterians, we followers of the Reformed faith that is ever reforming, that God is the initiator of our lives, of our world, and of everything that is, including faith, hope, love, and acceptance. We cannot know God or even understand God or adequately conceive of God, but we get a small glimpse of God through Jesus Christ, God's extraordinary gift of grace. Jesus is God's radical decision to stoop down to our level and be human for a while, for just long enough to pull us out of our slothful, sinful ways. And Jesus did this by taking on our cause, by becoming one of us, by dying for us, and by purging us of all our fallenness. Jesus did this in a way that punched a gaping hole in the iron wall of death. Only by Jesus acting as our intercessor are we able to return to God transformed, transformed into the creatures of perfection that God intended us to be. The good news is that transformation is possible. Transformation can save us. Transformation saved the day back in 1940. I promise to tell you the rest of the story of alchemy and evildoers and gold. Here it is. When Nazi forces invaded neutral Denmark in April 1940, scientists in that country working at the Niels Bohr Institute of Theoretical Physics were already on alert. The Institute had been a refuge for German-Jewish physicists since 1933. Two Nobel Prize winners, Max van Lau, a German Christian physicist who denounced the rise of the Nazi Party in Germany and its persecution of Jewish scientists, and James Franck, a German Jewish physicist who had earlier escaped to America, had both sent their Nobel Prize medals, cast in solid gold, to the Danish Institute for safekeeping. The Nazi regime had made it a crime to send gold out of the country, and even gold within Germany was being confiscated to feed the Nazi war machine. So, with Nazi troops marching onto the streets of the Danish capital, a Hungarian chemist working at the Institute, George de Hevesy, decided to take action to protect the metals. He made them disappear. Hevesy decided to dissolve Lau and Frank's metals in a solution of Aqua Regia, Monk Basil's Red Fox. The process required several repetitions because gold, it turns out, is very stubborn. The metals, Hevesy wrote, were exceedingly unreactive and difficult to dissolve. Hevesy finally succeeded in turning the metals into liquid form after several repetitions, just as the soldiers were pounding on the doors. The two liquefied metals then sat in a beaker in plain view on a shelf, next to hundreds of other solution-filled beakers like it, like a hidden, crouching dragon at rest. The Nazis occupied the Institute and searched it very carefully, but found no gold. After the war, Hevesy returned to find the solution undisturbed, and he precipitated the gold back out of the acid concentrate. The Nobel Society then recast the two Nobel Prizes using the original gold sent to them from the Institute. And the medals were then reissued in solid gold to Frank and Van Lau in separate ceremonies. The Nobel Prize transformed, revitalized, all with the infusion and reworking and remaking of a process. Why not us too? Through faith, why not we also be made fresh in Christ, all shine new through faith? And faith is a gift. It comes from God as a predisposition to our yearning to come home. God kindles faith within us and promises salvation for all who follow, all who worship God, as opposed to worshiping money or fame or ourselves. Faith is within you already, coming to church, worshiping with friends, helping your neighbor. These all kindle the fire, the warm, safe love fire of faith that burns in all our hearts. There is chemistry here, as God imbues us with faith and love and mixes in that one holy, transforming agent, Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit. Protestant theologians call this process sanctification, a lifelong process of refining and purifying ourselves as Christian people through a life of faith. But we don't need a name for it. We can just trust in the promise of God to receive us at the end of this long lifetime of faithfulness, the warmth of God's love, that all-consuming fire melts away our imperfections, the sin that clings so closely, all our impurities, our little clay feet, our hardened shells, our stubborn selves. God melts us down into purest gold and smiles on our shining essence. God sees a glimmer of God's own image in each one of us, sanctified, perfect, and pure. God reshapes us into solid form, a heart of gold, a love locket, and inscribes it with God's eternal promise, forever yours.